I know that you guys divested from shipping back in 2003 from the Aboitiz Chongbian Gothong Group to focus on logistics and distribution. But you're catering the end-to-end needs of your clients. I imagine you still depend on shipping in some ways. Well, the shipping industry has been under tremendous pressure from soaring demand, freight prices going up, shortage of containers, saturated ports, too few ship and dock workers. What's the situation on the ground? What's your experience been? And what trends are you seeing over the last couple of weeks and months and the expected impact of this to your bottom line, to your operations?
Yes, Mimi. I think the international pressure on freight has been quite substantial. Domestically, we see a few shortages from time to time on raw materials and packaging materials for our customers. However, most of our fast-moving consumer goods customers have been stocking up on their very important inventories. At the moment, we do not see the kind of pressure that the international market is seeing. There are a few delays on shipments, but at this point, I think the Philippines is still quite steady in the domestic front.
Mm-hmm. Steady on the domestic front. Could you give us a snapshot, William, of supply and demand? I mean, you've got new COVID cases surging outside Metro Manila in provinces in Visayas and Mindanao. Are you expecting this new surge or wave in Visnin to have significant impact on your business, on your operations?
The good news, Mimi, is that we've been operating under this environment for over a year. We have been able to adapt to an environment where you need to be very specific in your protocols for safety of mm-hmm. our warehouses, our drivers, our trucks. We have a system that monitors the whole national supply chain. And so we've stuck to that. We are not seeing any bottlenecks at the moment. We do not foresee that there will be bottlenecks. But we are obviously one with the cities and the provinces that are going through these surges. So we're on red alert all the time, and we continue to watch it on a per individual basis, actually. So on any given week, we know the status of our associates and our contractors as well.
William, you mentioned this earlier, how a lot of your FMCG clients are stockpiling. Would you say that this is the trend these days, from just-in-time inventory to stockpiling, that this is the trend moving forward?
What I've seen, Mimi, and I the world leader when it comes to this, you know, the guys that did JIT, I think Toyota Motors in Japan had started mm-hmm. it, but they actually have a separate program called Rescue, which what it does is it tracks about 6,800 of its important parts. And over the last year or so, they have been stocking up to 4 to 6 months. Similarly, I think in the Philippines, our customers are doing the same with their very fast moving products. No? Mm-hmm. I think what's critical in the Philippines is that we are an archipelago that goes through severe weather disturbances. And what's happened is that I think we have a very adaptable supply chain. It can always get better for all of us, but we are adaptable. And yes, there is, I think, a little bit of stockpiling, but I would say it's quite healthy.
Mm-hmm. Okay, minus these perennial problems, you know, delays in shipment, rising costs. There's really so much going for your industry, William. I mean, the number one would be e-commerce booming, and this is going to really accelerate the growth of the industry you're in. You recently partnered, invested in great deals with Steve C with a $1.4 billion investment, but that's, of course, with a group of other investors. What's the latest on that front? Exciting, huh?
Yeah, I mean, you know, e-commerce has always been something that we've wanted to understand, and it's such an energizing way to try to learn e-commerce by joining the team of Steve C and Great Deals. They're the number one e-distributor in the Philippines by far, but it's really the energy that they bring in a sector. What's the excitement? The excitement is because in e-commerce, they are also enabling our own customers, we found out, in the fast-moving consumer goods space, like you've never seen before. So that excitement then for us translates, for example, into how can we then be relevant in the backroom services so that Great Deals and will grow tremendously as well. And so we're hoping to complement warehousing and transportation, so that if they just keep on growing, hopefully we can make the customer service as seamless as possible as well. But I agree with you, Mimi. Very exciting. It has created optimism in a very, very tough pandemic time. Yes, I completely agree. And so we want to stay relevant, especially when it comes to the cost structures in the new environment.
William, just give us an idea. What role will you play in the supply chain of Great Deals? Are you going to be in the warehousing? Because I know that you guys are building over 100. There's a plan to build over 100 mini centers, fulfillment centers across the islands. Are you going to be running those warehouses? Are you going to be doing the first mile or the last mile deliveries?
We are currently studying more on the first mile area together with Great Deals. They are independent. We need to be relevant to them. On the last mile, because we are nationally entrenched, we're trying to also help Great Deals find good last mile locations. They're very specific with their needs. But yes, it's our focus right now will be closer to the start of the deliveries.
Mm-hmm. And of course, are there any other partnerships or M&As that you're looking to make that are looking very interesting right now?
I think on the brick and mortar side, we continue to look for different formulas for partnerships in warehousing space. We continue to look for dry, ambient, and cold storage. Obviously, we need to link that through supply chains as well in transportation. And on that front, we're trying to complement it with a robust enough technology support as well.
Mm-hmm. Last year, William, CVC Capitals invested some $6 billion in Fast Logistics, primarily for expansion in the Philippines and regional. What kind of growth targets are you setting for this year? And is there a country outside the Philippines within the region that you're already targeting this early?
Well, we're targeting, I think, conservative double-digit growth. Externally, we are at this point, Michelle, we're really looking at macro. We're looking at, in terms of the areas that excite us, it's really, I think it's now called VIP, Vietnam, Indonesia, and the Philippines. Quite frankly, Michelle, we are looking purely macro right now. We like the young population. So we are trying to see where there is potential I'm looking at it as passive investment for now. We will focus on the P, on the VIP, and hopefully we find, you know, the cross borders, I think, are going to happen sooner more than later. We need to see how we can pipeline product in between the ASEAN countries. And when that happens, I think logistics becomes relevant in a very strong ASEAN way.
Wow, regional ambitions there, William. I know you're still awash with cash, but will an IPO be on the table for you? Is it something that you guys are thinking about soon?
Not soon, but definitely we're looking into an IPO. So what we're trying to do now is we're trying to really build up our enterprise. And again, it's to try to complement really the growth demands it's really just the new trends of urbanization, e-commerce. You had already mentioned there's quite a bit of stockpiling. And technology also allows us to give our customers service where they can be very intimate with their inventories on a daily basis. And e-commerce has shown us that inventories move so fast. And so we do need to invest in technologies. So we're also looking actually at investing in very, very innovative companies in the technology side.
Are there contenders? Are there candidates already for these possible investments? How many are you looking at? You must have names, William. You look like you have a few names.
Our partners have a long list. CBC have a long list. We're looking at about 3 to 4 at the moment to see how things work out. But it's really interesting. And again, this is heavily on sort of linking really the new sales and marketing needs of our customers, from the big multinationals down to the smaller local entrepreneurs who are so energized, but they need the technology to scale up. To complement their own ambitions. So we're trying our best to get that done. And so hopefully we are also investing in the enablers, trying very hard.
Okay, 3 to 4 companies you're seriously looking at. Quick question, are these local tech companies?
At this point, yes, they're local. They're local, Michelle.
Are you looking to close deals within the year, within this year?
We're looking potentially at least one before the end of the year. That's sort of our internal mandate. So we get traction.
Okay, William, exciting space that you're in. I can feel the energy. Thank you so much for joining us and for the insights this morning. Thank you for joining us.
Thank you so much, Michelle. Thank you.